Hello, band. How are y'all? Good, good. How is everybody this morning? Good to see you. Glad you're here. You're looking good. Most of you? Yeah. So glad you're here. Okay, we're set up for that. That's good. I have a confession to make. I came into the church earlier this week, and I think the band was practicing or the choir or something, and I looked at the song list for this week, and there was all these patriotic songs. And I'm like, Donna's lost her mind, because the 4th of July was a long time. And I said, Donna, why are we doing patriotic songs? Not that I care. I'm patriotic. And she was like, duh, stupid. She didn't say that, but I could read her mind. She was saying, Wednesday is Veterans Day. So thank you, Donna, for helping me, and I appreciate that. If you are a veteran or active in the military, would you please stand up right now? Anybody that served? There? Yeah, there, there. Wow, I'm loving it. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Amen. We appreciate your service. Thank you. How many Army? Yeah. Air Force? Navy? Marines? I know. I got you. All right. James says I'm meeting all outside, actually. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen and ladies, everybody that served. We appreciate that. Let's see. Shoe boxes, I think they're all gone. I think they're all gone. Thank you so much. We need you to turn them in, your Samaritan's Purse shoe boxes. Get them in as quick as you can because collection day is coming quickly. Okay. Another thing I want to mention to you as you leave today, the finance committee has gotten together. They've put together a proposed budget for the coming year. Okay. There's copies on the table on the left as you go out. Take it, read it, pray about it. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, we'll talk about it next Sunday morning, and we will vote on it, okay? Kind of a big deal. Take time to do that. Henderson County Toy Run is November 21st. It benefits the Henderson County Foster Children's Association. If you would like to bring in a toy for that, there's a box in, as you leave. On your right, going toward the nursery, a box right there. Bring in your toy. I think there's we got another week or so we can do that. Bring it in, and we'll make sure that we help a child with Christmas. Let's see. Ann Jones called me last night, and reluctantly, we hate to do this, but because of the COVID situation, for the go-getters, there will be no Thanksgiving dinner or Christmas dinner this year. Yeah, I know. It stinks, but maybe next year, okay? Jesse Tree, okay, where we our kids and families follow the lineage of Jesus Christ. I think there's two or three left. If you have children in your home, 12 years or under, please take one of these. There's instructions in it. It's really a blessing to do at Christmas, all right? If you have any questions, see me after the service. And I'll answer them for you, but there's only a few left. Take them first come, first serve. I also want to plug our new website. It's www.mmbc, Mount Moriah Baptist Church, hnc.org, Hendersonville, North Carolina. Go on it. They told me something this morning. You can go on, you can scroll. There's a place where you can just click on a button, and there's an archive of sermons. So, like, we're in the middle of a series right now. You're going, well, preacher, I didn't get the first ones. Go on the website. There you go. Bada bing. You can get caught up, all right? There's also online giving there. There's a picture of my wife on it. She looks great, okay? Yeah, events. Everything I'm giving you here is on there. How's that, okay? And so participate in that. Be part of that. And last on my list, but certainly not least, on Sunday, November 22nd, from 4:30 to 6:30, we're having the Bill Thomas Harvest Dinner to benefit the food bank, okay? Let me talk to you about food bank for a minute. In the back here, we have a whole storeroom full of food, okay, for anyone who is needy. If you know someone, okay, if you are that someone, please let me know or anybody in the Thomas family. They're going to wave at you right now, okay? You see them. You get in touch with me. You get in touch with Charlene. It's all confidential. Nobody knows anything, okay? And it's just, it's something that Bill Thomas and Bryce Caldwell started 9 years ago, and it raises money. All you got to do is on that Sunday night, okay, you bring in canned food, non-perishable food, or a monetary donation, okay? You drive up down to the rec building. They'll give you your meals. It's like better than Grubhub, somebody like that. All right? There's papers in the front here. You just fill out, I want four meals. I'm going to be here at 5:30. You drive up, and they make it happen, okay? It's so simple. But yet I know somebody's going, I don't know if I can figure this out. So I asked Bo, okay, our outgoing superintendent of Henderson County Public Schools, okay, how many days you got left, brother?
2 weeks, 4 hours, 45 minutes.
There you go. All right. There you go. To help us out, I urged him. I said, Bo, give us a commercial so we know how this works, okay? So let me set the scene for you, okay? I got to put on my announcer voice. Sunday evening, November 22nd, sometime between 4:30 and 6:30 p.m., this is a Mount Moriah Baptist Church member getting in their car, coming to the Harvest Dinner.
Oh, forgot. Safety first. It didn't start first service. Okay. Driving to church. Picking up my meals through the drive-through Harvest Dinner. I'm so thankful they kept this going in this crazy year. Man, it is so wonderful. What a truly blessing for our community, for the food bank. And I even ask, and I put a couple of extra dinners down on my sheet because I've got a couple of shut-ins I'm going to take it to. What a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. While I'm driving here to church, let me see, what's on the radio? Oh, 106 The Light. Oh, wait. Oh. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? I tear that song up when it comes on the radio. I tell you what, me and EO, we need to be doing a duet. Let's see, what do I have this week? Two kids, let's see. Johnny goes to school Monday, Wednesday, 8 to 4. And Susie's going Wednesday, Friday. If I found out the guy who made that school schedule, I'd kick his head. Let me see. Pull out in front of me, now going 10 miles an hour. What are you? Patience, patience. Man, he's preaching something. He just speaks right to me. Love those things. Keeps me awake and everything. Man, all right. All right, just pull down here to the church. They say, just stay in your car. All right, just I'm pulling right up. They're putting it in park. Roll down the window. Old school. Name, I'm a retiring. Yeah, Mr. Retiring. Yeah. I did 6 dinners. Here's my food right here. I put a little extra money in the box as well. Thank you. You're getting the food. Wonderful. Thanks. Oh, you're going to be right back with my dinners? There they come. Absolutely wonderful. Thank you. Oh, they smell so good. You have a blessed day. All right, let's go. Man, they smell good. Wow, turkey. Dressing, mashed potatoes, green beans, rolls. Kids would never know they're supposed to have a roll.
Thank you, Bo. I appreciate the fact that he rolled the window back up in the first service. He forgot, blew his hair all over the place. Yeah, yeah, amen. Let's get into the prayer list for just a minute, and I hate to begin it this way. Evelyn Davis called me this morning and said that her Uncle Tom passed away last night. Tom Ledbetter, Grayson's uncle, Peggy's brother. Please be praying for the Ledbetter Lauder family, if you would, please. And speaking of them, Robbie Davis, he went down last week to have another treatment for his leukemia. Had a really hard weekend. It's been a tough week for him. So be praying for Robbie, if you would, please. Continue to pray for Jody and Clara Johnson, Irene Haynes. Vicki Patterson had surgery on her foot this week. She's doing good, but she asked if we'd please continue to pray for her. Ashley Guffey, battling Lyme disease and a couple of other things. Ashley, we're praying for you. Diana Dietrich, Paul Vaughn's daughter, has been diagnosed with ALS down in Texas. Please be praying for her. And I got a call from Janet, Paul's wife, last night. He's back in the hospital. He was in earlier this week, got to come home for a couple days. Now he's back. He's dealing with some heart issues and blood thinners. And just be praying for Paul and Janet and their daughter, Diana, please. Ricky Carson with cancer. Joyce Price, that's Melissa Stepp's mom with cancer. Please be lifting her up. Evelyn Roberts, that's Kenny Roberts' mom. She's got cancer. Pray for her. Brenda Oimby, also cancer. Cora Thorpe had a heart attack. Be praying for her. Courtney Underwood, a teacher at Sugarloaf Elementary. Be praying for her. There are so many people in need this morning. How about you? Unspoken request today? I've got many. If you can, stand up. Be with us today, and let's pray together. Lord Father, we glorify you today. We praise you. We thank you for the opportunity to be together this morning in your house, to be with you, to have an encounter with you, Lord Father. We come here, Lord, we've come here to sing. We've come here to worship. We've come here to hear your word. But most of all, Father, we've come here to be with you. And I pray, Lord God, Father, that you just meet us here. Fill this place with your Holy Spirit. Touch each and every one of us, Lord Father. Lift us up and help us, Lord Father. Lord, there's so many people here today, right here this morning, people watching us online who are facing worries and troubles and situations. And Lord Father, sometimes life gets so overwhelming. We just need you, Father. We pray that during this hour we have together, Lord Father, that you just move in our situations, our circumstances, bless us, and help us. We pray for all those who are sick and afflicted. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, Lord. We pray for Tom Ledbetter's family, Lord. We pray, God, that over the hours and days to come, that you would give them the strength they need. Give them a peace and comfort that is beyond their comprehension. Lord, Father, we pray for our nation. We need you, Father. Please have your hands upon us. We pray for our church. We need you here. We need you in our community. Lord, Father, we need you most of all in our hearts. And Father, I pray, if there's someone here this morning or someone watching online who's never given their heart to you, they've never said, Lord, I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. Father, let today be that day. We love you, Father. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you for being here today. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, thank you for being here today. We're all here for one thing, to worship God. Amen?
Amen.
Yes. Did you bring your voices?
Yes.
All right. Let's
they
sing.
They should know this song.
Yeah, y'all should know this song, A New Hallelujah. So on the bridge, we're going to go, whoa, whoa. And y'all are going to go,
whoa, whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. See, y'all got this down, man. Y'all are grooving this morning. So, but y'all have done really good the last couple of weeks participating in at least one song that today you're going to get to do two. But we'll get to that in a minute. Let's sing A New Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
my feet are on the rock. We want you to say, my feet are on the rock. The very last one, I want you to crack the ceiling tiles. I want it to be loud. I want it to be proud. And I want you to be thankful that your feet are on the rock.
Amen. Yes.
So when you hit that one, you better hit it loud because we're going to. So just be prepared.
Ooh, ooh.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Praise the Spirit, three in one.
And everybody in God's house said, amen. 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 Man, I'm glad to be here this morning. Anybody with me?
Amen.
I'm so excited. I brought two Bibles. I'm going to preach out of both of them, too. You ready? Oh, goodness gracious. Did anybody come to church this morning expecting anything? We'll see. We're going to talk about that in just a minute. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you for the music. Thank you for the talent. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the time. Thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you for allowing me to stand before your congregation and preach and teach. And Father, I pray, Lord God, that you would use me in a mighty way, not for my glory, but for yours. Speak through me to your people. Fill me with your spirit and help me, because, Father, I cannot do this without you. I pray for your people. open their eyes, open their ears, but most of all, open their hearts so they can receive what you have for them today. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go to the book of Lamentations. Lamentations. Some of you are going, I ain't never heard of that. Lamentations. It's a little bitty book in the Old Testament between Jeremiah and Ezekiel. Okay? Little bitty book there, Lamentations. We'll be reading out of it in just a minute. We're going to be going to chapter 3, verse 24. You're going, now, preacher, I didn't bring a Bible with me. That's okay. We'll put the words up on the screen for you in just a few minutes. Okay? We're in a series of messages where God has been talking to us about patience. I was going to talk about patience for 1 week. 5 weeks ago. But God's got me camped out here because y'all ain't listening. I was at an event last night. I had a wedding to do, beautiful wedding, and I had multiple people come up to me, and the wedding was crowded, and there was lines to get food and drink and all of this stuff. I had a few people come up to me, and they said, "Preacher, I hope you're still preaching on patience tomorrow." Yes, I am. Anybody need patience today? Anybody need a big dose? Okay. We started out talking about having patience with each other. Patience with people and situations, things that irritate us and aggravate us. Okay. Then last week we went a little bit deeper, okay, because I realized that being held up in the checkout at the grocery store or having to wait too long for our food at a restaurant or being stuck in traffic, those are really, folks, those are just little inconveniences, amen? In the grand scheme of life, those are just little things that we have to deal with compared to other things. All right? It's going to happen. Get over it. Okay? There, I just did a whole half of the series right there. Just get over it. Yeah, you're going to drive down Four Seasons Boulevard and you're going to get caught in traffic. You're going to go down I-26, you're going to get caught in traffic. Somebody's going to give you a one-finger salute. You're going to have to wait for your food at the drive-through. People are going to jump in front of it. Get over it. That's life. Okay? God wants me to keep going and talk about or talk to you people that are really having to wait. Okay? Waiting for something to change in your life, waiting for something to get better. All right? Let me give you some examples. I gave them to you last week. Some of you are waiting for a prodigal, for a child. Some of you lay awake at night and you're worried about this child that you love so much, you're waiting. Some of you are waiting for a spouse or for someone you love to find God before it's everlasting too late. Some of you are waiting on a marriage to improve, and you've been waiting a long time. Some of you are waiting for the sickness to be healed or the pain to go away. Some of you are waiting for the financial situation to be healed. But you're waiting and waiting, and you've been waiting. I call this being in God's waiting room. Has anybody ever been in God's waiting room? Okay, I've been there. Some of you have been praying for days, months, even years, waiting for an answer, waiting for a solution. Maybe somebody in here is waiting for a miracle. Something so big, something so out of hand, so overwhelming, something so mountainous, you're going, "Lord, it's going to take a miracle." And I've been waiting a long time. Did I mention that waiting is hard? It's no fun in the waiting room, is it? It's tough. So here's the question. What do we do while we're in God's waiting room? What do we do while we're waiting for our lives to change, for things to get better, for somebody to come around or be healed? How do we make it through that? I mean, obviously, we're not just supposed to sit there and, come on, God, come on, God, come on, do something. I don't think that's what we're supposed to do. So God gave me four words to help us out. I gave you the first word last week. Number one, when we're in God's waiting room, we wait faithfully. We wait faithfully. What do you mean, Pastor? I mean this. We trust God's timing. Amen? We trust God's timing. That's easy to preach. Hard to do, isn't it? We trust God's timing. Knowing. Preacher, how can I trust God's timing? Because we know that He has not abandoned us. He promised, I will not leave you nor forsake you, didn't He? That's a promise, and God cannot lie. He cannot break a promise. He said, I'm going to be with you no matter what. And you can know that. And you can know that just because God is silent doesn't mean He's still. Just because you're not hearing something doesn't mean He's not doing something. Just because you can't feel Him or see Him, you can have faith, confident faith, that God is behind the scenes of your life in a whole nother realm, and He's working things together for your good. I like that. I like that. So this morning, let's talk about the second word God gave me. It comes from Lamentations chapter 3, verse 24. The prophet says, the Lord is my portion. You know what that means? It means He's all I need. Come on, y'all. The Lord's all I need. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore I will hope in Him. The Lord is good unto them that what? Wait for Him. To the soul that seeketh Him. You see, there's a part A and a part B. He says we're to wait on Him and seek Him. We're looking for Him. Looking for Him to do something. Verse 26, it is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. Everybody say amen. The word wait there. I had everybody say it. Say it again. Wait. Wait. I read this about 2 weeks ago, and it just set me on fire. The word there, wait, in the Hebrew, in the original language, is the word quava. In Hebrew, quava. You know what quava means? It means to wait, looking for or expecting something great. The second word for us when we're in God's waiting room is we must wait expectantly. Say expectantly. Can I preach to you for a minute? Y'all okay with that? Nobody's going to get scared, are they? Because this is a Baptist church. We don't preach too much. All right? I'm not going to get ugly. I'm not going to yell. But I got to tell you something. Okay? And I want you to, I got to say it in a way that you'll understand it. Okay? Here we go. Are you expecting anything from God today? No, I want you to be honest. If you're not, I don't want you to say a word. Okay? Because actually, church, here's the preaching part. If we're really honest, most of us would answer, well, you know, not really, preacher. I just come to church, I try to live my life, and I pray that God won't let anything bad happen to me or my family. We're really not expecting anything. We just want to get through this thing alive. Amen? Now, that's the truth. That's the way most of us are. Listen, a lot of us didn't even come to church this morning expecting anything. And you know what you're going to receive? Nothing. See, a lot of you came in here and you were expecting me to lift you up, or you're expecting the praise team to lift you up when you needed to come in expecting God to lift you up. And see, we're just people. We can't do that for you. Only God can. Some of you came in here, though, and you expected God's Holy Spirit to show up and be mighty and do something in your life. And right now, you're giddy inside. But again, because you're in a Southern Baptist church, you're afraid to show it. Somebody's inside right now going, man, I got to go to church of God so I can run around a little bit. So I can shout and say amen. Let me come at you from another direction here. Does anyone here this morning have faith in God? You got faith in God? Okay, now let me clarify myself. I'm not talking about saving faith. I'm not talking about saving faith. I'm talking about faith in God concerning your situation, your hurt, your worry. Anybody got into that? Some of you are going, shoot, yeah. I'm in church. I'm righteous. I got me some faith in God. What you're really saying is this. Well, Pastor, I believe God can do anything, which is all right. But church, listen to this. All of us believe God can do anything, but very few of us are expecting God to do anything. Do you see the difference? Some of you came in here believing, yeah, God can do anything. Some of you came in here going, yeah, God's going to do something. I'm expecting it. I'm looking for it. Faith in our great God is expecting our God to do great things. Does that make sense this morning? Faith is expectation. Expectation is faith. Let me give you a little illustration here of waiting expectantly, okay? If you've been in church here very long, you know the story. You're going to get to hear it again. Some of you are new, you don't know. Many years ago, we got together, we were praying, we were seeking God. The church was full, overflowing. Okay, this is what you're sitting in. Was it here? It was about a third of this size, and it was full every Sunday morning. God is blessing us. I mean, people were coming to the door. Remember, Greg? Visitors would come to the front door, and they would look inside and couldn't find a seat, and they would turn around and leave. We got to do something. We got to do something. We need to tear this thing down and build something bigger so we can serve this community, so we can reach more people for Christ. And we started praying, and we met, and we got together, and we had us a plan. And about 2008, you know, God put $500,000 in the bank, and the deacons and the finance committee said, okay, preacher, get your little self out to the bank. Get us the rest of the money we need. And we're going to build a new church. That was the plan. And I knew God was going to do it. I knew He was. I knew it. Anybody remember what happened in 2008? The economy died. I don't know how it affected you, but it affected my family greatly. Being in construction. It died. I'd go to the banks with $500,000, and the banks would go, we're not loaning any money right now. What? What? We don't owe anybody anything. Everything's paid for. We own the land. Well, God does. You know what I'm saying. We own it all. It's. We got it. We got the collateral. We knew churches around us that had built a year or two before who didn't have near that amount of money, and banks were throwing money at them. I went in one bank. I thought I had forgot to bathe that day. They treated me like I stunk. They said, boy, you need to hit the road. We ain't giving nobody no money. Now, I was disappointed. I was down. But I did not give up. Because I knew God was doing something. He wouldn't take me this far just to drop me off. And evidently, you didn't either. We were all waiting expectantly, waiting for God to do something. And the reason I know that you didn't give up and that you were waiting, because for the next 2 years, I watched the building fund grow another $250,000. We didn't even talk about it. We didn't. I don't even think the building committee didn't even meet, Greg. I think we kind of stopped meeting and said, well, we're just going to wait for the right time. But waiting expectantly, knowing God's going to do this. We just got to wait expectantly. Toward the end of 2010, I get a phone call just out of the blue from one of the construction companies that we'd talked to. They said, Brian, y'all still interested in building that church? Not interested. Going to. They said, I'm past interested. They said, well, we got a new plan very similar to yours. We think we can build it. What do you think? I said, let's take a look at it. We took a look at it, brought it back to the church. The people agreed. This is important, church. When two or more agree on something, God's getting ready to move. Okay? As long as this group wants to do this thing and this family wants to do that thing, you're not going to accomplish anything in a church. But when the people come together and say, yeah, we're on it. The Sunday after Mother's Day on 2011, we started tearing the old church building down. And all along, people kept telling me, you can't do it, you can't do it, you can't build a new church. I'm not exaggerating. I would go to the general store in the morning on my way to a construction site, and at least once a week, some good old boy who knew more than any, they didn't go to church here, but they knew what we needed. They said, you can't build that church. I said, I'm not going to. God is. I'm not going to raise a hand. God's going to do it all. Well, you can't do it. I had this conversation at the general store. I said, why can't we do it? Because you don't have enough doctors and lawyers at your church. You don't have enough money. I was told that. It's all right. God's got more money than any doctor or lawyer I ever met. In fact, he's probably bought and sold a few in his time. I said, that's all right. I said, I got some apple farmers, school teachers, factory workers, got a few barbers in the church. I believe we'll just go ahead and do it anyway. Thank you very much. The Monday after, or the Sunday after Mother's Day 2012, we walked into a brand new $1.25 million facility you're sitting in. We borrowed $250,000 just to make it the way God wanted it. Borrowed the money for 10 years. Paid it off in two. Don't owe anybody anything but to love them and tell them about Jesus Christ. Why? Because we waited expectantly. We knew God is a God of His Word, and He's going to do what He said He was going to do. And since then, the church numerically has tripled in size. Let me give you three things real quick to remember when you're in God's waiting room and you need to wait expectantly. Number one, remember how God has delivered you in the past. See, some of us are in God's waiting room and we're fretting and we're worried because we're facing this big obstacle, this big mountain, and we've totally forgotten. Isn't it amazing how when we face one problem, we forget about all the other problems we already come through? How God has already delivered us through all these other mountains. We're facing this one, but if we look back, man, He got us through that one and that one and that one and that one and that one. See, our memories are bad. We need to remember how God has delivered us in the past. All of us have been in situations we didn't think we'd make it through. Amen? Anybody been there? But here you are. You made it. Amen? Some of us shouldn't even be here today. You shouldn't be here. Some of you have fought cancer, disease, sickness, been in accidents. I shouldn't be here today. You've heard me tell this before. In 1972, I was just a little boy. This is, for y'all real young, this is before they had seatbelt laws. Allie, there was a day when I was a kid, you didn't have to put a seatbelt on. And in fact, you could sit in the back seat of the car between mom and dad, between the seats, and just ride like that. And if it was a long trip, you could get up in the back, back window. I don't think they make cars like that anymore. You have to be old like me to remember those cars. No seatbelt. You know, you're driving along, you're resting a little bit, and you know, dad tapped the brake, just messed with you, you fall in the back seat. Anybody been there? Yeah. Well, one Sunday afternoon in June, me and my dad, my uncle, my dad's driving, my uncle's in the front, my brother's beside me. He's small. I'm between the seats. We're in Fletcher, going out 25 toward Asheville. Now, I don't remember all of this. This is what I was told. I lost all that memory, and you'll know why in just a minute. A car pulled out in front of my dad, and instead of hitting the car, he tried to swerve to miss the car, and he just couldn't react in time. There was a telephone pole right there, and hit the telephone pole. It killed my Uncle Marvin immediately. He was dead on the scene. I went through the windshield of the car and landed on the hood, they tell me. Fortunately, Tim was beside me, and he was behind Dad's seat. So he was still cut up and bruised. But they tell me I was in a coma for 72 hours. And they told me later, you know, I was little, so they just gave me information as I got older. But Mom told me later, said there was many hours there they didn't know if I was going to make it or not. But God saved me. God saved me. Physically, he rescued me. Some of you have been in that same place. You've been in a dark place, a place where you shouldn't be here, but he rescued you. Beloved, here's my point. If God has rescued us before, why can we not? How can we not expect him to rescue us again? Amen. Number two, remember this. Remember that God meets you at the level of your expectation. God meets you at the level of your expectation. Somebody's going, preacher, I have no idea what you're even talking about there. Let me put it in Eddyville language for you. If you expect little from God, that's what you're going to get. If you expect a whole bunch from God, that's what you're going to get. God meets you at the level of your expectation. That's what he bases his blessings on. You want big blessings? You better expect a lot. You want little blessings? Expect little. And that's what you'll receive. I knew a man years ago. I worked with him for about 9 or 10 years. Great guy. I respected him. Loved the man. But he had a life motto. And this was his motto. And it may be yours too. Okay? His motto was this: blessed is the man who expects nothing, for he shall never be disappointed. Think about that. Blessed is the man who expects nothing, for he shall never be disappointed. I get it. That's logical. If I expect nothing out of life, then I'll never be disappointed by life. I understand that. But that's a sad way to live, isn't it? It's especially sad when we apply that philosophy to our relationship with God. When our attitude is, God, I'm not going to ask for a lot because I'm afraid you won't give it to me, so I'm just not going to pray that prayer. I'm not going to ask for a lot because, you know, what if something happens? I'm not going to. Beloved, listen to me. Too many of us are expecting too little from God. Do you hear me, church? We're expecting too little from God. And when we do that, we're not giving him enough room to work in our lives. You serve a God who wants to do great big things. I'll see y'all later. I don't think you're getting it. I don't think you're getting it. Instead of waiting for God to bless us, too many Christians are waiting for something to go wrong. Okay, now you're with me. You see where I'm headed? See, it's like we're going through life, and instead of expecting something good from God, we're expecting something bad from life. And because we're fleshly people, we dwell more on what we can see than what God can do. It's like we're just waiting for something to go wrong. And that limits what God can do in our lives. It's hard to expect a lot from God when you're expecting the worst from life. A man, businessman, he was on a big trip, working hard, visiting customers, having meetings, do all that stuff. He finally made it to his hotel room about 11 o'clock that night. He's just wore out. He sits on the edge of the bed, takes his shoe off. Whew, not thinking, he just drops his shoe. Boom. He goes, oh, gosh, there's people under me. I shouldn't have done that. It's late at night. So he took his other shoe off, untied it, laid it down gently. Got in bed. About 20 minutes later, he heard a knock on the door. He went, opened the door. There's a man standing there in his pajamas, bags under his eyes, eyes red, hair messed up. He said, sir, can I help you? The man standing outside the door said, yeah. Go ahead and drop the other shoe, please. He's just waiting for something to happen. Just waiting for the other shoe to drop. Beloved, that's us. That's us. We're just waiting for the other shoe to drop. We're just waiting for something else bad to happen. Let me get personal with you. Some of you had a bad day yesterday. Some of you had a good day yesterday. I get it. But some of you had a bad day yesterday. You know what I'm talking about. Don't stop expecting great things from your God. God sent me here not just to preach to you, but to cheerlead you a little bit. God is working all things together for your good. The church is good. The Christian's good. He's working it together. Don't let one day defeat you. God is still on the throne and God is still good. What do you need today? You have a big God who wants to bless you in a big way. Wait expectantly for Him. When you're in that waiting room, you should be going, Lord, I don't like being here. I'm not comfortable. This stinks. But I am waiting for you to do something big for me. Number three. When you're in God's waiting room, waiting a long time, remember who God is. Church, one of our biggest problems is we don't know God. See, we know about God, but to most of us, God is some faraway force or something. You know, he's good and he loves us, but he's not very involved. Nothing could be further from the truth. God is very much alive, very much involved in your life, and very much wants to have an intimate relationship with you through His Son, Jesus Christ. Let me put it this way. God's your daddy. God's your heavenly Father who loves you, who cares for you. Listen to this. God's on your side. He's not up in heaven waiting for you to mess up so He can throw a lightning bolt and light your backside up. That's not the God you serve. He didn't get up this morning trying to punish you. He is for you. He's on your side. Listen to this. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles 16:9, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to bless them whose heart is loyal to them. Let me put that another way. God is looking for people who are expecting him to do great things, and he will. Are you one of those people today? Are you? Because if you came in this building and you weren't, I hope when you leave you are. How many people are saved? How many of you are saved? Your heart belongs to Jesus Christ. His word promises that he's searching for you. He's looking for you to do great things in your life. All you've got to do is make room for him and expect it. Expect big things. Beloved, listen. I did the expect little things for a long time, and that's exactly what I got. My God's big. I look for big things now. Big things. I can't wait to see what God is going to do next. No, life's not going to be perfect. There's going to be pain. There's going to be heartache. There's going to be hurt. I understand that. It's going to happen. But in the end, overall, God's got big things for me. He's going to bless me. He's going to bless you. Listen, when you're in his waiting room, waiting for something to start or for something to stop, waiting for something to get better, waiting for that child to straighten up, waiting for the finances to get right, waiting for the marriage to fix itself. Listen, you can wait on God confidently and expectantly. God's for you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to do great things for you, with you, in you. Let me close by telling you about a woman who had a big problem. She was in God's waiting room for a long time. But she expected God to do something big, and he did. This is out of Mark chapter 5, verse 24. You don't have to go there. I'll give it to you. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. That's Jesus. Jesus is a rock star. Do you understand what I'm saying in today's terminology? Everywhere he went, people wanted to touch him, be near him, hear him. They wanted Jesus. So he's walking down the street, and the Bible says he's pressed with people. That means there's hundreds, if not thousands, of people just pressing against him. And he's just walking through this crowd, and they're walking with him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. That's a long time to be in God's waiting room, isn't it? She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet, instead of getting better, she grew worse. Here was a woman who was looking for some healing. She's been in the waiting room. She wants to be healed from this ailment. She wants to be socially acceptable again. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd. In my mind's eye. Now see, you got to understand the day. It's not like it is today. Back then, okay, you got to understand the time. It was a man's world. You with me? Women didn't just walk down the streets wherever they wanted to. So this woman had to make some effort. And in my mind's eye, in order to get past the men who were there, I can imagine that this woman gets on her knees and she sees Jesus, he's coming. And she knows all she's got to do is touch him. I just got to touch this man. I got to touch him. And he walks by. And for just a second, she touches his cloak. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Isn't it cool that she didn't say, I might be healed, I could be healed, something might happen? No, she said, if I just touch him, I will be healed. Now, I don't know about you, that makes me want to pee my pants. I'm sorry, Internet, that's the only way I could get their attention. That gets me excited, church. She says, if I can just touch him, I will be healed. What do we call that? Faith. We call that expectancy. For 12 years, she'd been in hell, and she decided, I know God can deliver me. All I got to do is get close to him and touch him. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. Isn't that cool? Jesus is God in the flesh, walking down the street, and he's so sensitive to his people, somebody can just touch him, and he can go, some of my power just left me and went to somebody else. I want me some of that. He turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? The disciples freaked out. They did. Verse 31, quote, you see the people crowding against you, and yet you can ask who touched me? The disciples are going, you're surrounded by hundreds of people, but yet you feel one person touching you? That's the God we serve. He can feel my touch, your touch, the tiniest touch. God can feel it and he's sensitive to it and he moves. Who touched my clothes? Poor old disciples, they're just like us. They just church folk. They don't understand. Jesus, how do you know somebody touched you? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, what happened to her? She got healed. She was out of the waiting room. Somebody finally came to the door and said, you're next. Come on in. Then the woman, knowing what happened to her, came and fell at his feet and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. And he said to her, daughter, your faith, you're expecting something from me, has healed you and made you whole. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. Band, come on up. Congregation, stand up. Somebody here this morning needs a little bit of healing. Somebody here this morning, you've been waiting a long time. Somebody needs to come up here and touch Jesus. He's up here. He's waiting on you. He's at this altar. This whole stage is an altar. God is waiting on you. He's saying, come on. Come on. I've got the power you need. I have what you must have to be the people you need to be, to have the life you want to live. He's saying, why do you keep suffering? Why even keep waiting? Come on down. Let me have it. Beloved, somebody here, you need to come down. You need to give that thing to God. Somebody's here and you need to rededicate your life. Oh, you're saved. You know all the songs we sing in church. You pray daily. You even know some of the Bible. But your passion's gone. Your fires went out. And you need to come down here and you need to, Lord, I rededicate my life to you. Give me a spark. Start this fire again. Some of you need to walk down here and just lay your burden down. Some of you need to walk down here and you need to get saved. You need to ask Jesus Christ, Lord, I'm a sinner, and I'm going to go to hell if I don't get saved. And I know you're the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to heaven except by you. So I come down right now, and I give my heart to you. Somebody needs to do that. Whatever you need, you do it. None of us are promised tomorrow. Don't leave here today the same way you came in. Amen? Father, we love you. We thank you. We give you our praise. We are thankful that you are a good God who loves us and who expects us to expect things from you. And not just ordinary things, but miraculous things, big things, good things, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I pray that as we sing this song, that you'll have your will and your way with every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.